96KX suitcase with Paul Stanley.
Hey, you gonna do any more solo albums?
I don't know. First, we gotta do a Kiss album, because everybody keeps wondering if we're breaking up, so we're gonna show everybody and we're gonna do a new album.
Welcome to KISSTORY, my overly ambitious series on the history of my favorite rock band, Kiss. This is episode 7, and for this episode, we are gonna go back in time to the summer of 1979. Let's flash back. In the summer of 1979... Kiss hadn't released a new studio album in about 2 years. They hadn't toured in the United States in about a year and a half. And so you can imagine how thrilled Kiss fans were when many radio stations in about June announced that they had a new Kiss song to play everybody. Kiss had put out a brand new song, they were going to put out a new album, and they had the first single all ready to play. All the Kiss fans lined up, listened to their radio stations, and this is what they heard. Yeah. Now, even if you're not a Kiss fan, you probably know that song. Even I was at the gym today, and it came up on their generic classic rock playlist. It's everywhere. It's all over the radio. And it's probably one of Kiss's most endearing songs over all the years. But you have to remember what it was like at the time that that song came out. There was a fierce sort of war between the rock fans and the disco fans. You pretty much, if you were in high school in the late 1970s, you were either a rock and roll guy or you were a disco guy. And Kiss was like one of the top rock bands in America at the time. More than that, they were known for being unapologetic, loud, heavy, you know, they had explosions and stuff. They were the big, they felt like they would never compromise. And then when Kiss fans heard this song, many of the more hardcore Kiss fans were horrified. Not happy that, was my favorite band switch to disco? As it was a marked change in their sound. They were using producer Vinnie Poncia at the time, who had previously produced Peter Criss's solo album, and he his work with Kiss gives him a definite more poppy sound. Yeah, it was not a hit with the hardcore Kiss fans of the time. But Kiss wasn't all that worried for a couple of reasons. First of all, they had a demographic shift in their fan base. Many more kids and even parents were liking Kiss music now, partially because of the enormous crossover success of their ballad hit, Beth, in 1976, and the motion picture that NBC showed, Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park, in 1978. And on top of that, just serious, just intense merchandising. Anything imaginable, even back in the 70s, perhaps especially back in the 70s, you could get with a Kiss logo pasted on it. It's still true today. And so kids were seeing Kiss-related stuff in the stores, and parents were becoming more okay with buying them stuff. And so, and also, more than that, Kiss was mostly known for their live show, and they had a huge live tour planned for North America at that time. And, I mean, their music was never particularly critically acclaimed anyway. I mean, it was mostly the shows that people cared about. And this brand new show was supposed to be huge. They were booking all the biggest arenas and more that they had ever played before. And, for example, they booked 5 gigs at Madison Square Garden. They planned on selling out 5 gigs there. And they did 2 shows in... They scheduled, rather, 2 shows in Pittsburgh, 2 shows in Philadelphia, 2 in Largo, 2 in the Detroit area at the huge Pontiac Silverdome. And these shows were heavily promoted, and it was supposed to be huge. They were supposed to tour with a traveling amusement park called Kiss World. I'm not making that up, it's true. And they even designed their stage in such a way that it wouldn't have a back wall, so they could even sell the tickets behind the stage. They really anticipated an enormous demand for this tour, and as is kind of a theme for Kiss, they vastly overestimated the demand for such massive events. But we'll get to that in a second. in the summer of 79. This is the album Dynasty that was eventually released. Now, I Was Made for Loving You, and perhaps the second single from the album, the other Paul song, Sure Know Something, are fairly pop-oriented, but there's a lot of rock and roll on this album, too. It's not a disco album by any means. The song has a bit of a disco flavor to it, but it's mostly a straightforward rock album, with a bit more of a pop edge than they had had before. I Was Made for Loving You was a much bigger hit overseas than it was in North America. I think it was a hit in South America. I know it was a hit in Australia, and it was pretty well received in Europe as well. But they actually didn't tour overseas in 1979. All of their touring was in North America. And when it came time for the tour to actually start, like I said, they didn't sell nearly the tickets that they thought they would. It wasn't terrible. They did some decent numbers, but 3 of the 5 Madison Square Garden shows were canceled, bringing them down to 2. And most of those 2-nighters that I had talked about became 1-nighters. And with the lack of additional overflow, tragically, they canceled the Kiss World Traveling Amusement Park concept. But the shows were big spectacles. They had a brand new, incredible lighting rig, brand new effects, including Gene Simmons would fly into the rafters when he played God of Thunder, a trick that he still uses today. And Ace's guitar would also float up into the rafters, which is a trick that I believe now Tommy Thayer has adopted and they're still using in concert. So the shows were visually spectacular, but the band was falling apart. All 4 of them pretty much hated each other. I mean, Gene and Paul, as usual, had such hyper-inflated egos by this point that it was impossible to work with them. Ace was becoming quite an alcoholic, and Peter Criss was just the most, out of the 4, it's pretty much known that Peter Criss was the most difficult of all of them. He had quite a temper to him. He had some alleged cocaine use that really didn't help. Actually, Peter was even doing things like he would grind the tempo of songs to a halt just to piss people off. And he would mess up the lyrics to Beth, depending on who you ask, either accidentally or even deliberately, to sabotage that song for who knows what reason. Came to a rather hilarious climax on Halloween night of 1979 when Kiss appeared as guests on the Tomorrow Show with Tom Snyder. This has become a very famous tape amongst Kiss fans as the like humorous drunken Kiss interview.
When you see the audience going crazy, what goes through your minds? Do you have time to think about audience reaction while you're performing?
I feel like I'm in a movie. I always get the feeling that I mean, when you realize that a lot of the people at the show have been waiting 3 or 4 months to come see us, and this is like the big night for them. And when you see all these people screaming and crying and all that...
Screaming and crying? Why did I spend all that money? I spent all this money.
This is it. He goes up to the air. We're out of here.
True confession time. Right here.
Huh?
True confession time. Right here. Exclusive on the Tom Snyder program.
I stole this from Flash Gordon, and I have my cape.
But you're kind of like a spaceman, huh?
No, actually, I'm a plumber. On the side.
No. Well, listen, I got a little piece of pipe backstage I'd like to have you work on.
Tell me about it. Oh, you won't let it, but I'm like dead.
You.
You
roll it?
You well, old sweet talker, you.
Ace was just hammered. Legend has it he even passed out in his green room after their interview finished. And you can just see how horrified Paul and Gene look at Ace and Peter just running off with this interview. It's so funny to watch this footage in retrospect, but at the time for the band, it really wasn't. Things were falling apart, and after that, the tour limped along for about another month and a half. After about 6 months, the tour concluded on December 16th, 1979 in Toledo, Ohio, and the band basically took separate limousines home and didn't speak to each other after that. And there was the big question at the time was, is this the end of Kiss? Has Kiss run its course? Spoiler alert, as you no doubt know by the fact that Kiss continues to tour and perform to this day, the answer was no. But significant changes would be made in the upcoming years. And to be frank, they didn't really help. Kiss was really on the downward slope by this point. It was really all starting to fall apart. And for some reason, I find this part of Kiss's history equally as interesting as their rise to fame. Thank you for watching this episode. That'll do it for the Dynasty era of KISSTORY. In my next episode in this series, which will be in a week or two, I don't have an upload schedule for these videos. I just do one every week or two when I have the time. Next video will be on their next album, Unmasked. And as you know, if you're a huge KISS fan, 1980 was a year where KISS made some massive changes and a lot of interesting things happened. So that'll be a fun episode. Thank you for watching. For those of you who don't know, I'm also a professional musician myself. You can find links to my upcoming performance dates as well as links to where you can find my music where it is sold or streamed online in the description below. Like this video if you liked what you saw. Subscribe to my channel if you've been enjoying my videos. And you can even ring the notification bell if you would like to be notified every time that I upload a new video, which this is a daily vlog for me as well. I use this channel to sort of show my life as a professional musician and my touring life and all the cool places I'm visiting. So yeah, new content just about every day. So yeah, catch you with a fun new vlog again tomorrow. See you then.